2, we left off talking about G protein coupled receptors and the heterotrimeric G proteins. We will pick up the heterotrimeric G proteins and their coupled receptors again when we get to talking about second messengers in cells. But for now, let's move on and consider another type of receptor for signals involved in cell communication. There are, for example, lipophilic hormones like the steroid hormones, estrogen, testosterone, sex hormones. And those lipophilic, that is, lipid-loving types of hormones can pass through the hydrophobic environment of the interior of the plasma membrane and therefore can move into cells directly. So they don't need, these types of hormones, these lipophilic steroidal hormones, don't need integral membrane protein receptors in the plasma membrane. Rather, their receptors are found in the cytoplasm within the cell. And when the when the hormone binds to the receptor, it kind of becomes a co-activator of the cellular response. Because what happens is that when hormone binds to the steroid hormone receptor, for example, the hormone receptor changes its conformation. The lowest free energy state of its conformation changes such that it assumes a new conformation, and that exposes a nuclear localization signal or a DNA binding site. And that causes the transport of the receptor plus bound ligand, plus bound steroid hormone, into that complex is transported into the nucleus through nuclear pores. So that conformational change basically removes an inhibitor that blocks the nuclear localization signal. And then subsequent transport into the nucleus allows the receptor and the co-receptor, which is the hormone itself, to bind to target genes directly. So this is a very direct pathway to changing gene transcription. Some of the other pathways we'll be talking about are more indirect, but the steroid hormone pathway is very direct. Hormone diffuses into cells, binds to a receptor, and together the complex is translocated into the nucleus where target genes are activated directly. So this is a very quick and short way to change gene transcription. And we know that steroid hormones do just that. They cause the activation of target genes directly. So now we're ready to move on to receptor tyrosine kinase receptors, another class of receptor proteins involved in cell communication. So we'll talk about that in just a second. Receptor tyrosine kinases are transmembrane proteins with an extracellular domain that can be bound to ligand, that can recognize an extracellular signal. And when that happens, these proteins dimerize. They associate with each other in the plasma membrane. It's as though the ligand brings those individualized receptors together to form dimers. And when that happens, the intracellular catalytic domains of these receptor tyrosine kinases phosphorylate each other. And they phosphorylate each other at tyrosine residues because these are tyrosine kinases. So they call this autophosphorylation when they phosphorylate themselves. But that phosphorylation event activates other proteins as well. These kinases not only phosphorylate themselves, but also phosphorylate target proteins and activate them. And for example, let's look at the insulin receptor in liver cells, for example, that receives insulin. This is a receptor tyrosine kinase type of receptor. And when ligand is bound, when insulin is bound by the alpha subunits of these receptors, dimerization occurs, and the beta subunits autophosphorylate, and also phosphorylate an insulin response protein. And when that insulin response protein is phosphorylated, it activates an enzyme called glycogen synthase, but only when it is phosphorylated. So glycogen synthase becomes active and converts free glucose to glycogen, the storage form of glucose. So when you eat a big sugar meal, your insulin will respond and lower your blood sugar, your blood glucose, by causing target cells to take that glucose and lock it into polymerized glucose, which is glycogen, a storage form. So glycogen synthase is the enzyme that catalyzes that storage reaction, and glycogen synthase is only activated when you have phosphorylated insulin response proteins, and those are only phosphorylated when the receptor tyrosine kinase is autophosphorylated and also phosphorylates the insulin response protein, and that only happens when insulin is bound by the extracellular domain of the protein. So here we see a cascading effect on a cascading effect causing a change in cellular behavior that's based on transduction of an extracellular signal into an appropriate cellular response. Now, something about phosphorylation cascades that we should talk about. This cascade is the mitogen-activated protein kinase cascade, MAP kinase, which stands for mitogen-activated proteins. And in schematic form here, we have a signal, which is bound by a receptor that causes an activator to be activated. And that activator turns on a first kinase. And that first kinase phosphorylates a second kinase. And that second kinase phosphorylates MAP kinase, mitogen-activated protein kinase. And that activated phosphorylated MAP kinase phosphorylates response proteins. And those response proteins are then responsible for eliciting the particular cellular response. And here, when we're talking about the MAP kinase cascade, we're often talking about a cell division initiation. So growth factors that are causing cells to divide will activate MAP kinase cascades. So let's look at this in slightly more schematic form here. Here is a receptor tyrosine kinase responsible for binding a growth factor. We have autophosphorylation. And that autophosphorylation, in this case, activates not a heterotrimeric G protein, as we've talked about before, but a monomeric G protein called RAS. When RAS is activated by the phosphorylated intracellular domains of the receptor here, the receptor tyrosine kinase, RAS activates a MAP kinase kinase kinase. And that's how we have to refer to this, because this is a chain of events, as we will see. So when MAP kinase 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 becomes activated by RAS, which in turn is activated by the receptor, which is in turn activated when ligand is bound, then MAP kinase 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 phosphorylates MAP kinase kinase. And that activates MAP kinase kinase then. And then MAP kinase kinase phosphorylates MAP kinase. And then MAP kinase goes from an inactive to an active form. And then MAP kinase is responsible, in its active phosphorylated form, is responsible for phosphorylating response proteins that elicit a cellular response. So why would cells evolve this complicated, convoluted scheme, you might ask yourself? And that's a very legitimate question. But let's consider the value of this pathway. And that is, even a small amount of signal can be amplified greatly over a very short period of time, because these are enzymes. These kinases are enzymes. And what do you know about enzymes? You know that enzymes are not used up in any chemical reaction that they are catalyzing. So every enzyme can catalyze hundreds of reactions. And that means that if you have, let's say, one molecule of signal here that activates one MAP kinase kinase kinase, and each one of those MAP kinase kinase kinases can activate 100 MAP kinase kinases, and every one of those MAP kinase kinases can activate hundreds of MAP kinases, you can see that what we have here is a vast amplification in a very short period of time of what might be initially a very weak signal. It would be like if I tagged someone in the classroom, and they could tag other people, and those other people could tag other people, the rapidity with which everyone in the room would be tagged would be much faster than if I had to go around tagging every individual person in the classroom. So this is a signal amplification cascade, and that's what these phosphorylation cascades achieve for the cell. And here's a blown up view of that. And we've already gone over this, so you can freeze the movie at this point to look at it in a little more detail. And here's the signal amplification cascade again. You can freeze the movie if you want to look at this in a little more detail at a little higher magnification. Now, excuse me. It turns out that these enzymes that we're talking about are just not floating around loosely in the cytoplasm, depending upon chance forces to bring them together, simple diffusion forces. Rather, they are assembled. Often, these kinase cascade enzymes, that is, the kinases involved in a kinase cascade, are assembled onto a scaffold protein. And the scaffolding protein acts as a way to juxtapose these interacting, cascading kinases that will eventually target response proteins. And those response proteins then can diffuse in the cell to elicit appropriate cellular responses. But the protein kinase cascade proteins are often found assembled on a scaffolding protein. And here's another example of a receptor tyrosine kinase, in which activates RAS when ligand is bound. RAS, in this case, activates RAF. RAF activates MEK, which is a MAP kinase, basically. And MEK activates ERK. This is a protein phosphorylation cascade, and response proteins are eventually phosphorylated. In this case, these response proteins move into the nucleus through nuclear pores and activate transcription of target genes. So the transcriptional profile of a cell can be changed by binding of extracellular ligand and the transduction of that signal through a protein phosphorylation cascade that will turn on genes, that is, change the transcriptional profile of the cell. Now, at this point, in the next part of this lecture, we're going to turn to back to our G protein coupled receptors that we introduced earlier, and we're going to look at the cellular responses in terms of what we'll call second messengers. And we'll look at how the activated heterotrimeric G protein, that is the alpha subunit of the heterotrimeric G protein, when activated, causes the activation of effector proteins that lead to the production of second messengers. And that is where we will pick up with in the next part of this lecture.